And once again, we are Eclectica Cafe. He's Chance. I am Dustin. And this episode is minimum wage and mandatory government salary. Just a reminder, like, subscribe, retweet. We are everywhere. Twitter at Eclectica Cafe, Facebook.com/Eclectica Cafe, SoundCloud.com/Eclectica Cafe. Look for us on iTunes, look for us on YouTube, wherever you're not listening to us right now. We are probably on everything else that you could listen to us on. So check it out and join us in the conversation. Like cheese
before
dip.
We get going, I just want to throw something out there, mostly just because I want to get your perspective on this.
Okay. And
if anybody's listening that has anything to contribute,
leave it in the comments.
I would really
send us a Facebook, send us hate mail on email, whatever.
I don't know if this is going to necessarily warrant any kind of hate mail or anything, but I mostly just kind of want to get closure in this. It's been kind of bugging me the last day, and I just want to get it out there. It's got nothing to do with the conversation we're going to have. But have you ever met somebody that you don't even really know, but for very little reason or very not even a good reason, you really just want to stab them in the face?
Yeah,
do you ever
something
get that?
About them just really sits
yeah.
wrong.
Yeah. Well, I know exactly. I mean, so a couple weeks back, I went to a Halloween party for a guy I work with. Great guy. Great people I work with. But there was this one guy there that was, have you ever known the guy that plays, he sits and he plays like top 40 songs on the guitar and he just like
yeah,
really
and
wails
everybody
on
thinks
him.
He's so cool.
He's like fucking amazing and he definitely thinks he's amazing.
Yeah.
And he's like, he's just belting out these top 40s, and it's
three
like
chord progressions,
and you know
it could
that
be any song in the world.
Yeah, and it's like it's very obvious, like you're doing this to get attention, mm-hmm. you're doing this to be kind of the center of attention at that point, and to kind of especially attract the opposite sex, right? And so I saw.
Oh,
this
you're cool. You know five chords,
right?
Yes,
I saw this guy a couple weeks ago on Halloween, and I was like, I was watching him and he was sitting in the living room and just like, just jamming out. And, you know, it was camp. It was like super campy. It was like disgustingly, just over the top, just kind of gagged.
Right.
Know? But, so yesterday I went to the same guy's house, for a surprise party for him, for this guy. And this guy playing
right.
the guitar was here again, right? And he was talking
so
about
two different guys. The surprise party is for one friend.
Right.
The other guy, the guitar guy. We're not going to call him friend. We're going to call him guitar guy.
Right. I've never met him before. He's just shown up at both of these things.
Oh, okay,
so he's like, he knows the guy that lives
sure.
there. And, so yesterday I was at a surprise party and he was there again. And this time he's going on about how he does stand-up comedy. And like that's his thing,
oh
is he does
Lord.
Stand-up comedy, and he's talking to this girl that I happen to know, and he's talking to her conversationally. But I'm sitting back and I'm observing this because that's what I enjoy doing. I like to kind of just like deconstruct people
sure.
and just observe. And
that was half the fun of going to Vegas, but
right,
yes,
and just like like just sit back and as opposed to interjecting myself into what's going on, just kind of like let people make asses out of themselves and learn from it.
Right.
So I'm watching this guy and he's straight up trying to pass off a conversation, but I can tell he's reciting his comedy bits. Like that's how he's talking to her. He's talking to her by.
He's working out a routine while he's trying to chat up a girl.
He's reciting his routine, and that's him breaking the ice with this girl. And I'm like, fuck, dude. And what's driving me even more crazy is like she's like, oh my god, ha, ha, ha.
You're so funny.
And, yeah,
take
and,
me now.
So I'm just watching this, and yeah, I don't know. I don't know why if that should bother me as much as it
is. It's annoying,
but,
sure, but I don't know that it should dwell on anything. It's
right. I
like,
mean, it's like it's.
Where,
you know,
did you have a vested interest in any of
no,
the people
no,
involved?
No, I mean, no.
Then
no.
It's whatever.
It's no harm. I mean, it's whatever. But like, you see people like that, you know, and it's like I know what's going on. Like, I know that you're trying to like fucking pull some
right,
shit. You're
right.
trying to like look like you know, a lot cooler
to look and cool shit. Yeah, yeah.
Than you really are. And it's like, yeah, it's I'm not buying it, and I hope nobody else is buying it at the same time, right? Yeah. But anyways,
so minimum
the topic
wage.
At hand. I just want to get that off my chest. That,
if we could, so I kind of wanted to start on the note of the minimum salary requirements.
Yeah,
definitely benefits me.
Yeah,
because so I will be getting a modest raise, nothing crazy, but it's still a raise. Right. I will be getting more money every week.
And that's what prompted you to want to discuss
yes,
this.
Yes, that was the start of it. And then Colorado, since we just had the elections a week ago, week and a half ago, something.
Yeah.
Something like that. A few days ago. I don't know. Every day is the same to me. We passed a new minimum wage law, which is also fucking ridiculous. So even though I am benefiting from the first of these two laws, I still think they're horrible. The first thing I wanted to touch base on is more to do with the minimum wage law than the minimum salary law. It's a Department of Labor Mythbusters page. So somebody in our government very, very biasedly put together this page on their website. Pardon me. That busts the myths, quote unquote, of raising the minimum wage. So I just wanted to go through a couple of these, and it's not super long. So if you want to check it out, I'll put the link in the description below. But it's on the departmentoflabor.gov website. It's really easy to find. So where is the ones that I wanted to do? Myth: increasing the minimum wage will cause people to lose their jobs. Not true, according to this website. In a letter to President Obama and congressional leaders urging a minimum wage increase, more than 600 economists, including 7 Nobel Prize winners, wrote, "In recent years, there have been important developments in the academic literature on the effect of increases in the minimum wage on employment. With the weight of evidence now showing that increases in the minimum wage have had little or no negative effect on the employment of minimum wage workers, even during times of weakness in the labor market, research suggests that a minimum wage increase could have a small stimulative effect on the economy as low wage workers spend their additional earnings, raising demand and job growth, and providing some help on the jobs front," end quote. We will get to dissecting these in just a moment. I just want to go through them real quick. Myth number two that I wanted to touch on. Small business owners can't afford to pay their workers more and therefore don't support an increase in the minimum wage. Not true. Again, according to this website, a July 2015 survey found that 3 out of 5 small business owners with employees support a gradual increase in the minimum wage to $12. The survey reports that small business owners say an increase would immediately put more money in the pocket of low-wage workers, who will then spend the money on things like housing, food, and gas. This boost in demand for goods and services will help stimulate the economy and help create opportunities, end quote. Myth number three that I wanted to touch on, increasing the minimum wage is bad for business. Not true, according to the Department of Labor. Again, who is this lefty fucking author? Academic research has shown that higher wages, therein lies the difference, higher wages sharply reduce employee turnover, which can reduce employment and training costs. So, myth number one.
So we're going to break down.
I want to break down these three myths real quick, and then we'll talk about percentages and how businesses actually work. Myth number one. Increasing minimum wage will cause people to lose their jobs. The point that this makes suggests that a minimum... this is towards the end of the quote.
What's the premise that increasing minimum wage is going to cause people to lose their job? Because they can't afford...
The logistics of it go. If, let's say there's been a guy in the field. Let's use restaurants as the example, since I know restaurants.
Okay.
Let's say there's a cook who's been cooking for 20 years and is now worth $12 an hour. Okay? Then let's say there's a new cook
at 20 years, though, he's going to only be worth 20.
hypothetically speaking, but if he's just a cook, potentially in our area, yes, $12 to $13 an hour is a very well paid.
Is there like a, you know, $12 at this type of restaurant is that the equivalent to like $12 at, I don't know, like kind of like a shittier restaurant? I mean, or is it kind of like the same across
the board? It's kind of the same across the board in Northern Colorado. That we kind of live in a bit of a petri dish when it comes to this. Yeah, that's a high average. The average starting wage of a cook, regardless of employment, you know, if it's somebody who has years of experience, I'll start them at $10.50. That's starting wage. My assistant right now makes about $13. So yeah, that's that 12 is after you've been in the field for 10 to 15 years, 20, oftentimes 20 years, $12 an hour is something that you are worth at that point.
Wow.
Yeah. Jeez. Yeah. Restaurant industry is tough. So, but before I took over as chef, that's what I was making. I was making $13 an hour and I've been doing this for 12 years now. So, a guy who's been in the field for a long time, years and years, decade plus, making $12 an hour and has earned that $12 an hour. A kid just entering the field makes $9.50 to $10 an hour as we stand right now. That gives him aspiration, right? That means, yes, he cannot support a family on that. That's not what we're debating at this point. But is he worth $12 an hour? Is his cost greater than his value, or is his value greater than his cost? So his value as a cook is he produces food at a rate at which he earns $12 an hour. He deserves $12 an hour. And first
is
restaurant,
the company getting their money's worth.
Right, exactly. Right. First,
more bang for the buck.
First restaurant job, probably not. He's probably worth $9.50 an hour. The guy who's been doing this for a while is probably worth every penny of $12 an hour. Now, raise that minimum wage requirement to $12 an hour, and both of these guys are applying to the same job.
Right.
Who am I more likely to hire?
The guy with more experience,
right. Now and now,
so you're saying that the other guy's not going to get the training.
The other guy's not going to get the training to get his way up. So he's going to be a mediocre employee the entire time because he's never going to get the proper job/training.
But isn't there the thought process though that by increasing the minimum wage, though, you reset that, the ceiling.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Which, and we'll get to percentages in a minute. But that's the basis for this point is research suggests a minimum wage increase could have a small stimulative effect on the economy as low wage workers spend their additional earnings until the economy catches up and raises the bar for poverty. Like that's the key phrasing in this. Research suggests that minimum wage could, so it's not even for sure. There's no hard evidence, according to this, have a small, how small and how for how long,
but is
will
it
stimulate?
Can they really give a concrete
data? Yes, there is data. I'll get into that as we get a little bit further into this.
Like I'm just throwing this out there. How can you have any sort of concrete data on that when it hasn't been
done yet?
The
European Union gives us all the data. Because there are countries in the EU that have minimum wage requirements and there are countries in the EU that do not. And if we look at their poverty levels as the countries with and without, you know, as the countries with raise their minimum wage, and then you take a look at the poverty levels the following year, they increase dramatically. Whereas the countries, and I have the graph, I'll pull it up. Whereas the countries who don't have a minimum wage requirement, so they are not raising that minimum wage expectation, fairly level. They have their peaks and valleys, but they are not nearly as drastic. So therein lies the hole in the first myth. The second myth.
I mean, hold on though. Let's back
sure,
up. I mean,
go for it.
I just don't. I don't know if necessarily that could be the case when inflation is always
inflation
needs to be
happens
factored
regardless.
In.
Yeah, right. Absolutely.
Like you can't. I mean. you look at the 1950s, what was a cook making in the 1950s?
Probably
what was,
$2 an hour.
Right.
So the balance between inflation, that automatic inflation that we get anyway, and artificially inflating inflation, which is to press minimum wage faster, I feel like we have it as it stands, because right now the state of Colorado, again, minimum wage is not anymore something that a man can nor should try and support a family on, or a person, I guess, since we're in the age of political correctness. I have another article that kind of addresses that specifically, but keeping in mind that minimum wage, when minimum wage is enacted in 1938, how many teenagers had jobs?
Probably most of them.
I don't know about that. High school age kids?
1938?
Yeah.
I mean, at that time, though, you're thinking of Depression era, I guess.
Right.
I
mean,
they're competing against people who
actually
need jobs.
That was part of the reason. That was minimum wage and welfare both were enacted because of the Depression. But even before the Depression, it's not a common thing for a kid to have a job because dad is making the money in the time era in which this was enacted. So it made sense to give him a wage in which he could raise it and take care of his family, correct? That made sense. However, as we have progressed and more people are in the workforce and less dependent on, or are more independent, they don't have dependents, so they need less money to survive. Minimum wage then adjusted, not through any sort of political act or anything, but just through the course of nature, adjusted to be a starting wage in which you could take care of yourself. I mean, not right. super well, yeah, but you can scrape by on minimum wage.
You're starting out, you're
exactly.
getting out on your own. Maybe you have a couple of roommates, but are there not people that work in food service though, cooks, that, you know, that is their aspiration, that is
yes.
something that they want to do?
Yes.
And do you think that, like, are all cooks the same, or all or is there a different level of or a hierarchy of
yes.
this guy's, like, you know, kind of a peon, this guy's more closer to being a chef,
yes,
and are more deserving of a higher,
yes,
higher wage,
and by increasing the minimum wage, those people who are worth more money are getting the short end of the stick mm-hmm. because they're worth the money that they're getting, but the minimum wage is a dollar behind their wage. So some kid who I just hired is making a dollar an hour less than this guy. So in order to retain him, I yeah. have to then give him more money.
Do you see there being any possibility that you simply, you know, the minimum wage, let's say, is now $12 an hour for that young kid
right.
who's starting out as a cook, saying, you know what, I think that my cook who's been doing it for a decade, I want to bring him on because, you know, I trust his skill set better, and I'm going to start him out at $14 or $15 an hour. Do you see that being a likelihood?
No, that's what's going to have to happen. And again, we'll get into how the business operates in a second based on the percentages. So yes, that's what is going to happen. But where am I going to get that extra $4 an hour for that guy?
Food put it cost. On the menu. Yeah,
exactly. And then what's going to happen? Nobody's going to eat at my restaurant because my food's too expensive. You know what I mean? It's
so
a fucking
it all
cycle.
Comes out in the wash. Yeah.
It all comes out in the wash, and then everything else will have to raise because of this. So, I mean, that's the point that I want to make with this episode is we're shooting ourselves in the foot. You know, look at fucking Germany before World War II. It was literally a week's worth of way of pay to get a loaf of bread to eat. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
that's the direction we're headed. So, continuing down these myths.
Do you think, real quick, I mean, do
sure.
you think that there should be a minimum wage at all?
Yes. I do believe
there should be a fair wage.
I believe it should be a minimum wage. I believe it should be a starting wage that a high school kid
yeah.
can, you know, have expendable cash. That should be the minimum, and then
yeah.
it should be earned beyond that.
And I guess what's bothered me, and I remember, I don't know if it was about a year ago or so, there were Taco Bell employees that were that were protesting for $15 an hour, mm-hmm. I think.
In California.
And what sort of, I don't understand about that is, like, these aren't jobs that you typically think of as being jobs that you get to support yourself plus another person or to support a family.
Right.
These are jobs that are like stepping stone jobs or jobs that you pick up to kind of like pay some extra bills or to have some extra.
What that also does when you know, it's a menial job getting paid this $14, $15 an hour is it decreases the desire / need for education on the undereducated / underqualified workers' point of view, because
they can just chill at Taco Bell.
They can just work at Taco Bell and make $15 an hour. I don't give a shit. I can fucking full tacos all day. Like, how is that good for the economy? In what universe does that make sense?
Well, and I don't think I made $15 an hour until I worked full time at the military.
Yeah.
So, and those were jobs where I was working my fucking ass off from the time I got there till the time I went
home. Busting my ass. The first job I made more than $10 an hour was Walmart distribution. I was working in a warehouse fucking throwing boxes for 11 hours a day.
Yeah.
Throwing big ass heavy boxes. You know what I mean? And that was $12 an hour, and I had insurance because I worked at the warehouse. But I was killing myself.
Yeah. No, me too. I've worked.
I was earning my wage. Yeah, like, it was ridiculous.
All those jobs that I had, I felt like I could go home at night and I know I earned every single penny and then some that I worked for. But I mean, is that a good thing though? But
yes.
What you're saying is
it creates work ethic.
It creates work ethic.
It diminishes sense of entitlement.
It does. But there's a point though when you, I don't think it's as black and white as maybe you're presenting it as, where employers will and can take advantage. And,
yes, I believe that's a thing
and
too.
Try to like squeeze every single ounce of productivity out of you that they possibly can.
Yep.
So I do think that there is a fine line between that. I mean, I remember I worked just before I started college. I worked on an assembly line for a Harley Davidson dealership in this area here,
right.
And I was only making $10 an hour. Granted, that was a little over 10 years ago, so there's a, you know, difference with inflation and everything now. But I would get there at 7 o'clock. We work 10-hour days, and Friday it wasn't even 4:10s. Like the fifth day of the week was mandated, so we worked
so it was mandated
well
overtime.
Over 4 hour or 40 hours. But yeah, I mean, you had to log and track on a piece of paper everything you did.
Yep.
Like, I was even like under the impression that we had to log, you know, whenever we
clocked out to go to the bathroom.
Yeah, I went to the bathroom. Like, that's how on your ass they were all the time. And I remember, like, we were supposed to be done at, I think it was like 7 to 5,
mm-hmm.
and that was supposed to be the end of the day. And then they changed it to work up until 5, and then you start cleaning up at 5. And they said because they want to get as much out of us as they can. And
right.
It's like,
but then on that fifth day, everything you did was overtime, so you got time and a half.
Yeah, but it's at that point, it's like, you know, I think when you mandate those extra hours, like, it's one thing if you want to throw it out there optionally, but when you throw it out there as a something that's mandatory, you have to be here beyond your 40 hours. That's a little different when you're salary as opposed to hourly.
Right. That's the point of salary, but
yeah, that's kind of like, you know, now you're cutting into my time. This is my time. I gave you my 40 hours a week. Like, I don't see how you can fucking mandate that. And it was what I'm getting at is, I know that I was used beyond my $10 of worth. Like, I gave them much more than $10 an hour worth of work every single fucking day in, day out. And it that carried on from, you know, when my next job, being a laborer for a construction company, working my way through college, man.
Right.
Like, I fucking, you know, worked my ass off. I worked in the snow. I worked in the cold. I worked shoulder to shoulder with ex-cons and illegal immigrants. And I, again, like, the guys that, or the people that ran that business, they always treated it as, they almost kind of took the attitude like, the employees are kind of scumbags and are going to try to get away with as much shit. Yeah, and they're going to try to get as much away with as much as they can. So we're going to like keep them under our thumbs as hard as possible. And So I'm just using those anecdotal examples as evidence of,
and
you know, there's a difference between creating work ethic, which it did, but there's also a difference of
exploitation.
Yeah, if I feel like, you know, I go and fucking grab a cup of coffee for a minute, I'm going to be seen doing that, and next time a fucking round of layoffs comes up, my number's going to come up.
Now, you know?
And I saw shit like that happen.
No, and that's why labor laws exist. So, I mean, like, that's understandable, but...
But it's hard when you work for a company where half the employees are legal immigrants, right, and they can just can your ass and replace you with somebody else.
It's true. And again, it's not like any system in this country is perfect. Everything is flawed. But... again, that's overtime exists. Overtime pay exists because people were trying to mandate longer than 40 hours a week.
Yeah.
So that became a law, and that's a reasonable law. I feel like time and a half. It's just you're raising the bar for poverty, and when you raise the bar for poverty, more people become poor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. I agree. I want to make sure that like we distinguish that there is a gray area.
There is a fair gray area. It's not that what are these two guys doing? It's not that I feel like anything's necessarily black and white, because we have to have a minimum wage so that we're not exploiting people. Nice chance to plug the blog that we just started. I just posted kind of a political blog that I touched on this very, very briefly. But I believe that corporations, any company, even small family, I believe that corporations, small mom and pop companies will take advantage if there was no minimum requirement for pay. I absolutely believe a minimum requirement for pay is necessary. And I also believe that it should increase slightly with inflation.
And it has.
And it does. Yeah. In Colorado, it does. Federally, it has not raised since, I don't remember that number, for a while. It's at $7.50. Right now, before this new law takes effect on the 1st of January in Colorado, our minimum wage raises, pardon me, 8 to 10 cents every year. Which is fine, again, for the purpose in which minimum wage serves today. But I feel like we've kind of been hanging on this, and we'll get to all these points in a little bit more detail in just a second, as far as my plan for it goes anyway. So, myth number two, the small business owners can't afford to pay the workers more, therefore don't support increase in the minimum wage. And then their point of... 3 out of 5 small business owners support a gradual increase in the minimum wage to $12 an hour. Would immediately, this, again, we're looking at the immediate benefits and not the long-term benefits with this myth bust. Immediately puts more money in the pocket of low-wage workers who will then spend it on things like housing, food, and gas. Creating a greater demand for these things in which there is a lesser supply. So then the prices of these things will go up. Mm. So again, the points of these is immediate gratification. Yeah,
it's one of those things that politicians do. They do things that look good on paper. They say things that in theory might make sense, but they don't look at what's going to happen immediately after, what's going to happen immediately following. And business owners, especially small business owners, are going to try to make up that loss somehow. They have to. So the natural way to do that is increase prices.
Right. Increase in minimum wage. Myth is increase in minimum wage. It's bad for business. The myth bust is academic research has shown that higher wages sharply reduce employee turnover and can reduce employment and training costs. Again, they left out the minimum wage. They left out that one key little word. Because, yeah, if I give somebody more than the person next to them, they're more likely to stay. The person next to them is more likely to leave because he's not getting more money. However, if they're getting exactly the same amount of money, it's a moot point. So, you know, take everything the government tells you with a grain of salt is kind of the message from this little Mythbuster thing.
More than that, I think it's like, look at what's beneath the surface a little bit. What else is going on?
Right.
And I mean, I think you can see the language quite a bit on the U.S. Department of Labor's website when they explain what had prompted this and, you know, why this is happening. And there's a quote on there that says it'll go increasing. This is not the minimum wage for hourly, but what we originally were talking about with the salary,
increase, right.
Says this will go a long way towards realizing President Obama's a commitment to ensuring every worker is compensated fairly for their hard work. And I, like I said, that is so blanket. That's so broad. Yep. That's so general. Like, what does that mean exactly? That's basically insinuating that every person in the workforce is essentially being dicked over. And this, you know, the government's kind of swooping in to save those people. And it does a disservice, I think. You're right by saying that it's the government making themselves look grandiose or like I said, kind of swooping in as the hero or the savior.
Like they're doing us a fucking favor.
Well, and saving us from evil businesses or corporations or whatever. But I mean, I do think that there does have to be some sort of implementation put into place that does ensure, and there is, I mean, we have a minimum wage salary requirement. We have labor laws, but I mean, yeah, it is somewhat pandering. It is quite a bit pandering, this law. And again, yeah, I mean, like, if let's think of something like a movie theater. I don't want to pay a high school kid or, you know, somebody with no experience
$12 an hour
to tear tickets
and,
you know?
and clean up, you know, popcorn and maybe the occasional.
And like, who would you pay for a job like that? You know,
a high school kid who's not worth $12 fucking dollars an
like
hour.
Who, if you're like, you know, fuck that, I'm not going to pay a high school kid $12 an hour to do this job. Like, who's better suited to do that job? So that kind of puts you like, no, what I'm saying is like, there's not really anybody more qualified to do that job because it's not really a job that requires many
but
skills.
But is that a $12 an hour job?
And that's the point, is like, there's not really, you know, a large skill set involved. So like, what I want to say is like, I'm not going to hire a high school kid when I could hire, you know, somebody that's got some work experience, but it's like somebody with work experience probably isn't going to want to take a ticket to a movie theater anyway.
That's true. And in that situation, in that scenario, if you have somebody who has work ethic and previous work experience doing things like cleaning, which is effectively at least half of the job of a ticket taker at a theater, even though anymore there's no such thing as a ticket taker. You know what I mean? They're trying to minimize how many employees they have. So they have like one guy to work all of the projectors, and they have one guy to work the concession stand and take everybody's ticket. And, you know, so they're minimizing because of raising wages anyway. But in that scenario, if you have somebody whose skill set only allows them to take tickets and sweep half ass, versus somebody who used to work in the hotel industry and cleaned hotel rooms for a living.
You know
you're going to get a cleaner facility if you hire the person with more experience. You're going to get a better experience for your customers and likely more repeat customers when you hire the person who has more experience. So you're in the long run, again, if you look at the grander scheme, you're going to end up making more money by hiring somebody who's worth more money instead of just giving somebody who is only worth a menial amount more money.
But who's going to want to work that kind of job having, you know, let's say previous experience working at a hotel.
Maybe it's their second job.
Making $8 an hour, $9 an hour.
Maybe it's their second job.
Maybe.
You know what I mean? It's somebody whose skill set, I mean, that's the other thing that this would, if this were not enacted, would again force people. It's going to anyway. It's just instead of us saying $7.50, which is the $7.53 is the federal minimum right now. Instead of us saying $7.53, in 4 years we're going to be saying $12. Who's worth more than $12 an hour? Why would we pay somebody more than $12 an hour to tear these tickets when they're proposing raising the minimum wage to $20 an hour? Like it's just a self-defeating cycle. It's going to happen because people want more money for nothing.
The money's going to have to be made up for somehow.
Exactly.
So then in a couple years, $12 an hour is not going to be enough, and then exactly. that's going to be increased. And yeah,
we are artificially inflating the devaluement of our money. Like we are increasing it exponentially mm-hmm. by passing.
It's kind of robbing from Peter to give to Paul, because it's robbing from the businesses to try to create the illusion that people are getting more money in their pockets, but they're really just putting it back yep. right back into the system by. Yep. having to make up for the price increases of the products.
Exactly. So like I said earlier, I found, so there's a website called foundationforeconomiceducation.org. So FEE.org. Again, I will put the link in the description below. And I just want to read these first two paragraphs, or I'm going to read actually this first blurb from the editors. It's 2.5 paragraphs. Because it kind of crystallizes my comment earlier about, yeah, it's not enough for a man to raise a family like it was initially implemented as, mm-hmm. but it is still serving a very valid purpose.
So who was tearing tickets at movie theater? You made the example in 1938, kids weren't working in 1938.
Dude, but there was ushers. That was a thing. Like it was
A profession.
It was, yeah. I mean, not necessarily a profession, but it was a job that, you know, somebody with lower skill set could do and still, you know, make a couple bucks. And again, 1938, how many people were going out to the movies?
Right.
It is only in recent years, recent in the grand scheme of things, once again, looking at a larger picture, only recently, within the last 2 to 3 decades, become something that we do constantly. Whereas back then it was once every so often, maybe if you're lucky, if you could afford to go to the movies, because going to the movies was expensive.
It was an event.
It was a very big event in some cases. So you have to look at more elements than just, well, how much were we paying to go? Again, that's what it says. There's another, when it was enacted, minimum wage was like $2.15, and it's only gone up $5 in 60 years. And yeah, of course, because it's serving a different purpose now, because society has changed, our culture has evolved. We have different requirements for people who make money. Forgot what FEE was. Foundation for Economic Education, FEE.org. People don't like to think that anyone's labor is worth less than the minimum wage. Someone might end up flipping burgers for $5 an hour. You might think that the minimum wage is a way of paying some sort of dignity premium, hence language like living wage, quote unquote. People with such good intentions look at the direct beneficiaries of these policies, say burger flippers, now making $7.50 an hour. They pat themselves on the back, but they rarely count the invisible costs. Pardon me. Willing human beings who never get hired in the first place. But $5 an hour is not enough to live on, they'll say. For whom? A teenager living at home with his parents? An elderly person who wants simply to stay active? A single mom with 3 kids? A single woman living in an apartment with 2 roommates? Of course, not all of these people could live off of $5 an hour, but some of them could, given the opportunity. Concerns that those who couldn't don't justify minimum wages. Even
who could
if
live
we,
off of five, I mean, like who though?
Who's in live today's off economy, you can't.
Right. So
because we've raised the minimum wage to $7.50, but 10 to probably 15 years ago, when it was $5 an hour, 20 years ago, even, I mean, was minimum wage. That was what the living wage was. You know what I mean?
There was the living wage was $5 an hour
for somebody in 3 of those 4 scenarios. Sure,
but living wage denote like that's your sole primary income though? A living wage means this is what you're living off of.
Again, for people in 3 of those 4 scenarios, that is a living wage.
Who though?
The kid living at home.
Yeah. But he's not living off that wage. Like that's a supplemental.
The lady living, a single woman. Living in an apartment with 2 roommates.
Okay. Those, again, are all supplemental things, though. They're not, that's not your sole source of survivability.
So hence language, excuse me. Minimum wage is a way of paying some sort of dignity premium, hence language like, and then it, quote unquote, was living wage. Minimum wage is not necessarily intended to be that living wage.
Right. But so why call it a living wage then?
That's again, what they're saying is they're using fancy language to make it sound like it's something that everyone is owed.
Okay.
That the government owes this to its people to mandate that they have a living wage, which is self-defeating in its existence. So continuing on, concerns about those who don't justify minimum wages, even if we ignored the invisible cost of the policy, which include reduced margins to businesses that might otherwise grow and, in parentheses, hire more people. In other words, if you take off the bottom two rungs of the income ladder, many will never climb it. That's the effect of the minimum wage. The more cynical side of me, this is the editor again, says that's how many politicians and the overpaid Teamsters want it. Enjoy this great video, and there's a video, again, I'll have the link to the page in the description. But that's the point that I'm making is, generally speaking, somebody who needs a living wage, who is the sole provider that has no supplemental, anything,
yeah,
is making more than a minimum wage. There are those who have a limited skill set and no education who are only making minimum wage and trying to scrape by on that. But I don't have the statistics in front of me, but I know that the statistics would say they're taking care of themselves. They're not parents. They have no dependents. They're generally between the ages of, I think it was like 18 to 35, somewhere in that neighborhood. And minimum wage of in the state of Colorado, $8.38, I'm pretty sure is what it's at right now, is enough to live on when you're in that situation. It's not a very good living.
Right.
It's not very comfortable, but you can get by. And then you can also take advantage of other government programs to make it a little bit more comfortable, but that's a different podcast. Yeah. Here's the one with the graphs. It's called Let the Data Speak from the Cato Institute. Cato.org has, this is where the graphs are from the European Union. And you can see, and if I could shoot it in an email or something to you, you could pull it up too. The blue line, if you want to come around or something, you can take a look at this. These are the countries without minimum wage and their poverty level. These are the countries with minimum wage and their poverty level. Always higher because of the minimum wage, but when they increase the minimum wage, it goes even higher. And then there's a more specific even more pronounced when you look at the rates of unemployment among the EU's youth, defined by those younger than 25 years of age. When you look at that chart, it jumps even more. So we do have hard evidence of what this will do, because the European Milo Yiannopoulos says this all the time in his speeches. Not that I'm pro all of his policy ideas, but he always says America was so great because it wasn't Europe. So why are you trying to be Europe now? We can look at the model that Europe has given us and see how bad it is for this artificial inflation. There was one more. Oh, but that was a video too, and I don't want to play the video. So yeah, so like I said, we'll get into percentages. So basically, when you run a restaurant, you want your food cost to be about 30%. 28 to 30% is ideal food cost. So what I spend on food versus what I sell that food for, the money I spend to get that food into the restaurant should be 30% of what I then sell the end product for. Labor cost should be, depending on the restaurant, depending on what you're going for. I know restaurants that expect a 10% labor cost. So I'm paying, of all the money that we're making, 10% of that is going to my employees. My restaurant is not that low. My restaurant's right about 25%. So 25% of everything we make should be going to employees. Anything more than that means we have to raise the prices of food. So my food cost, because of this, is not going to immediately go up. So my food cost will remain at approximately 30%. If I change nothing, my employment cost, my employee labor cost, mm-hmm. is going to go from 25% to 30%. Now, according to the federal government, the average restaurant, non-corporate restaurant, for every dollar they bring in, they make 5 cents profit, is the ideal 5 cents profit. So that 30% of labor now is going to come out of that profit. And therefore, the restaurant is not going to be able to take care of itself. Because once that minimal profit comes out, you're only breaking even. Or worse, you're not even making money. And then that comes out of, well, we can't pay our rent, or we can't pay our heat, or we, you know, there's, so because of those percent, and it's a very tight, I feel it week to week, let alone month to month. I feel it week to week. Last week was slow. I can't afford to order that much food this week. And granted, I'll have some left over from last week, but there is, I feel the pinch immediately being the chef. So as soon as I have to start paying people more, I'm going to have to raise prices on my menu. It's basic economics, mm-hmm. basic economics. So because places in general must pay people more and then raise their prices to make up so that they can still make a profit, so they can still justify their existence in the world. It's the same point we've been making this whole time, is you're raising the poverty level. You're raising the price in which it costs to be poor.
Right.
And it's self-defeating. The one argument that I heard from somebody who voted for the new minimum wage law that I hadn't considered but still holds little water, very little water, is the ACA, Affordable Care Act. It is mandatory that you have insurance, and a small mom and pop owned company cannot afford to give everyone insurance because, like I said, we have very, very tight margins. So as a means to compensate for that, this person voted to increase the minimum wage so that people could afford their mandatory insurance.
And it just becomes self-defeating.
And then the price of insurance is going up. The ridiculous amounts. It's going to be fucking $300 a month.
So it's just another...
next year for me to insure myself.
It's another good example of the government saying, you know, this needs to be done so that these people can be taken care of, but not looking... The people not doing their due diligence of looking at where this is coming from. Up for all these lost funds.
Exactly. Yeah.
Makes sense.
You know, and so that's what drives me crazy. Like, again, I'm benefiting from one of these laws, from one of these wage laws. I am getting a moderate, not a significant, like I was about to say, but I'm getting a modest to moderate raise.
Would you say, though, so, like, we haven't really said too much about salary as opposed to hourly.
Right.
And I think that, you work some long, hard hours. You definitely work over 40 hours a week.
It's mandated that I have to work an average of 50 hours a week.
Yeah, and so, I mean...
But I usually do like 70 to 80.
Don't you agree then that there is a difference between that and the hourly labor laws?
So, all right, this is my stance on salary. Because this is not my first salary.
Because, well, real quick though, like what was previously the minimum salary requirements? Well, actually, I have it right here.
Yeah, pull it up.
So from the U.S. Department of Labor, it says the initial increase to standard salary level from $455 to $913 per week.
So that yearly comes out to what?
Let's see. And annual compensation requirement from $100,000 to $134,000 a year will be effective on the date on... December 1st. Future automatic updates to those thresholds will occur every 3 years, blah, blah, blah. So I'm looking at the wrong one here. Let's see. So the minimum originally was 455, right? That's what I'm showing.
455 a week.
A week. To 913 per week.
Right.
So, like, that's more than double.
Right, but I was not making the minimum salary. Okay, so,
but the minimum was 455.
Yes,
so, but that's a huge leap because to a minimum salary.
It hasn't been touched in 15 or 20 years.
That's a problem, though, right?
That is a problem. Okay. Yes, because again, because
and that's why system. I had to go back and reread it a couple times because they doubled it. Like it's literally been doubled or and more.
The system, like I said, in which Colorado has enacted in 2006, which now we've just fucking crazy augmented starting next year, wherein it raises a little bit every year. It's not according to inflation, but it is because of inflation. So in Colorado, minimum wage raises 8 to 10 cents every year, whereas the salary hasn't been touched, like I said, for about 20 years. The salary, we should have passed a salary law that did the same thing, that took where it was and then added, you know, $20 a week to the salary. You know, because that 455 comes out to like 23 and change, I think, for the yearly, whereas the 913 is like 45 and change. Mm-hmm. So I forgot the original question.
So is that a good thing? Like that they decided, as opposed to the hourly wages, is this an apples and oranges comparison?
That's right. So salary. When I took my first salary job, I was making more. I was working a lot more, but I was also making more every week than I was before when I was just hourly. This is not the job that I'm in currently. This was 6-7 years ago when I took my very first salary job. I went from pulling in paychecks of like $500 to paychecks about $900. But I was working 40 hours a week previously, and then after the salary kicked in, I was working about 55 to 60 hours a week. So in actuality, my rate of pay probably dropped. I've never done the math because I don't care. When I accepted a salary job, and I would imagine I'm not the only person who thinks this way, but this is the only... I have no evidence to back that up. When I took a salary job, it was laid out to me that I will be making this much money regardless of what I do, right? So there were some weeks when I worked less, but I still averaged about 55 to 60 hours a week. Because I was still making more money, like, I like what I do. Mm-hmm. Like, that's why you take a salary. I like what I do. I'm trying to help out the company
right. So
that they can continue to prosper. I'm not going to demand more money unless I feel I've earned it. And me getting a federally mandated raise is not money I feel like I've earned. I feel like I was going to be due for a raise shortly after this comes into effect, but probably not as substantial a raise as this. Even though this isn't a giant raise for me. But I feel like that should be taken into consideration when you accept a job that is based on salary. You get more benefits, but you have to work harder. And because you have to work harder, effectively your pay rate per hour goes down. But you're still making more money, and that's the reason you took the job.
Right.
Because you need the money and you enjoy it enough to do that.
Yeah, and I mean... Salaries, I mean, a different, like, it's a strange beast because you do have to, I really feel like you really have to be invested in what you're doing.
Yeah.
And, like, I always said I would never become salary for that reason. But, like, I look back at when I was in college and I was getting paid through the GI Bill. So, essentially, I was getting paid to be in school.
Right.
And I never thought of it as, you know, like, oh, I've already put in my 8 hours today for school, so I'm done for the day. And, you know, that's my... I did my work because I'm collecting a monthly stipend for working.
Right.
It was, or even when I was on scholarship in grad school, I got a monthly stipend, and it was, you know, there were days when I would be studying for 20 hours a day, you know, But I never looked at it as, oh, I've already put in my 8 hours for the day working. It was because it was something I was really invested in, I was putting myself into, and I was passionate about.
Now, I don't have any actual information behind this, but I've seen some stuff around. There was a video on a government website explaining why this was enacted, and at least part of it was because there are corporate secretaries. I forget the politically correct term for that position, but the secretaries, they answer phones, they type memos, who were making the minimum salary. They're paid a salary, even though it's a minor job. Mm-hmm. They are still paid a salary because that's the structure of the corporation, who are making just that 23 and change a year. Now, there is a law for people in that position before this, again, minimum salary raises. There is a law for people in that position that they still get overtime because they have no subordinates. They are not in charge of a section of the company.
That there's no reason that they shouldn't be getting overtime.
No, that is a law. That is a federal law.
That's what I'm saying, but like, they're not putting in extra time because they're managing other people.
Right.
So there's, if they are there for over 40 hours, then there's a good reason.
Exactly.
How's that tracked?
That's on the money department, whoever handles the finances.
Right.
They take an average work week.
I mean, what I'm saying is when you go in, do you punch in? So
yeah,
you're tracking. Okay.
But I have subordinates, so I did not qualify for this.
I've always wondered, as a salary employee, is that something that, you know, it's just assumed that you're putting in this many hours because you're for amount of time and you just get paid? Or?
Legally speaking, people who again, these corporate secretaries and things of the like, they were tracking hours. They have to track their hours in order to get that overtime. If you didn't track your hours, then you have no case.
That's what I'm saying.
Right. And then, like, you can't argue with the finances department to say, hey, you didn't pay me enough. Well, you didn't clock in, so how should I know? So, yeah, as a salaried employee, they still clock in.
One thing also that I want to bring up, and this is kind of the last point that I had on anything, was, so on both of these cases, salary and hourly, do you see there being some people who do, you know, like yourself, who do feel like that, you know, they want to put in a good day's work? Will it put a negative pressure on workers to almost burn themselves out, making sure that they are giving their employers the money's worth that they're being paid?
Because
I gave the example of how Taco Bell employees were petitioning and campaigning and protesting for $15 an hour. Like, I would want to make sure that I made the best fucking taco you ever got if I was making $15 an hour.
I better earn that $15, right?
So,
but
we are
of a generation that does not agree with the way we feel about it, unfortunately.
Maybe. I mean, I personally think that the baby boomer generation is the more entitled generation than millennials, but I don't know. Like, I think that that is another social element that maybe be considered.
I hire millennials regularly. No, that's not entirely true. I have worked with a few baby boomers. I've never been the superior to any.
Mm-hmm.
But I work with Gen Xers. I hire regularly people who are the generation before us, Gen X, and much better work ethic with those guys. The small handful of, and this is all super anecdotal, small handful of people who are older and would qualify as baby boomers, I've never had work ethic issues with. Always have work ethic issues with millennials and plurals. It is at least once a week that I have to address work ethic issues at work.
Sure. I mean, I don't know. That's kind of a different topic, but yeah, I mean, it is something though that it's going to be interesting to see how it plays out, because millennials, all millennials, regardless of gender, anything,
right. So
even social class, are already in the workforce. Whereas baby boomers that had much more of a luxury of being able to stay at home, getting a job straight out of college, being handed several jobs straight out of college, you know, that's the difference between the generations. And I think that could probably be a really interesting topic on its own, personally.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I feel like at this point we've kind of beat a dead horse, so I got no more points.
You changed my mind from the beginning. Cool. Well, again, you know where to check us out, facebook.com/eclecticcafe, soundcloud.com, Twitter. Our handle is at Eclectica Cafe, and look us up on YouTube. And...